year one, yeah. You sort of, yeah, okay, everybody else speaks Italian, but that's okay, so the tradition we do it in English as it is appropriate. Okay, so the title of my presentation is Embedded Intelligence and How It Will Improve Your Life, so they say, or not. Oops. Oh!
Dante!
Dante!
I don't know what's going on. Or not. So by the way, I don't know if anybody recognizes this character here. I'm probably dating myself, but now the evil robot or Professor Poindexter from Phoenix the Cat. Okay. Well, see, like I said, you know. Anyway, so here we go. So, like Franco said, a few words about myself. I am Max Chiodo from Crema, Italy. This is a little picture of my beautiful hometown of Crema that until a few weeks ago was completely unknown in the world. No longer true because they shot a movie that was a candidate for the Oscars this year. You probably recognize the picture. Yeah. Actually, this is actually
so what's the movie?
Call Me By Your Name. Anyway, it was shot in Crema and I actually grew up in a house right around the corner from where this photo was taken. Beautiful place, but you know, anyway. obviously, we have a problem.
You know what happens?
I might be able to afford it a bit better.
Yeah, look at this.
Yeah, sorry, guys.
Yeah, nothing.
Try again. I will use a different piece of that.
I want you to see.
Alright, so like I said, grew up in Crema, went to the Liceo Classico, and then I have a degree in physics from the University of Milan from 1984. So, you know, I worked in software and system development for mostly in industrial automation and real time embedded system. Worked for most of my working career in Italy was with Magneti Marelli, probably heard that name before. They're part of Fiat, they make electrical and electronic components mostly for the automotive market. When I was working for Marelli, I spent about 2 years as a visiting industrial fellow at UC Berkeley with the electrical engineering and computer science department. So when I was there, I met some people and talked with people, and as a result of that, after a while, I came to California in 95. And I've been here since. And I work mostly in the EDA sector. EDA stands for Electronic Design Automation. So developing software tools for IC development, IC as in integrated circuits. So basically tools that like simulators, optimization and synthesis of computer chips. Took a detour in bioinformatics, working for Complete Genomics. It's a company that has this interesting technology to do sequencing of full human genomes, which is different from most DNA companies. They do like samples, you know, they took a few. There are some people here that know a lot about that, more than me, probably you. But that was one of the few ones that did full human genome sequencing. Very interesting stuff. But then they took, anyway, good reasons to me. Done research and application in the field of system design, validation, verification, and recently I've been starting to work, get an interest in artificial intelligence and machine learning because of some of the projects that I've been working on. In fact, I'm going to tell you a little anecdote. When I first met Franco 2 years ago, I think it was 2.5 years ago at the New Year's Eve at the Italian Cultural Institute. One of the first things they told me is that, so we have this thing called Italia Geeks, and we give presentation different technical things. Why don't you give a presentation? I said, sure, I'll think of something. And I have no idea what I was going to talk about. It took me 2 years to come up with an idea, because 2 years ago, I knew nothing about what I'm going to talk about tonight. So I'm not an expert, but I think this topic is fascinating. I'm learning about it myself, so if you guys leave this room with not necessarily a lot of knowledge, but curiosity about knowing more about this, I would consider this a success, because I think it's absolutely interesting material. Okay, so, again, what is embedded artificial intelligence? So first of all, embedded is it's a term that not everybody agrees on, like Claudia will probably point out, but I'll give you a little, it's for fun, let's just look at this thing. It's a joke, but not entirely a joke. If I can find the volume here. Sorry about that. I can't find the volume, sorry.
Use the remote control of the...
And cyber-physical is something that interacts with the physical environment, both in terms of perception, in terms of producing actions, right? So think of a robot, classical case, without the mediation of a human, that is. And obviously machine learning, well, pretty much everybody, or you know, a lot of people know what this means, is a machine that is not, in which the functionality is not prescribed in the algorithm, but is learn from experience, essentially. So all of these elements are very interesting in their merit, but it becomes really interesting when you put them together. Okay, so example of systems embedded AI, obviously autonomous vehicles, adaptive robots, adaptive manufacturing, intelligent plug and play. So in terms of autonomous vehicles, most people will think of like a self-driving car. And that's a typical example that people probably think of. In my case, my experience is mostly in the aerospace sector. So I've been and will be again working on projects that have to do with autonomy in flying machines rather than driving machines. The interesting thing about that is actually a simpler problem, because when you're up in the air, you don't have a lot of obstacles, you don't have pedestrians, you don't have to know where the road is. You have very clear reference points. You do a mapping of the ground, of the whatever obstacle. Yeah, you should try not to crash into the mountain or do things like that, but it's a lot simpler problem in many ways, except maybe for landing. That's maybe the one exception. But other than that, it's... And typically landing, unless it's a, you know, tactical situation like a, you know, war zone or something, or an emergency, typically have a lot more input to determine where you have to land.
Well, you also have zones, no-fly zones in the air, you know, FAA restrictions.
Right. The question is, do you have to know where you are to know where the zones are? Mm-hmm. Now, you may have things like radio signals that will help you navigate there, but sometimes we cannot count on that. Again, in typical cases, if this is a commercial application, you may count on that, typically, unless there's a malfunction. If it's a tactical system, meaning a military system, you don't.
Yeah.
So, a very interesting field is that of cooperative manufacturing, and I will get to say a few more words on that later. Okay. All right. So what do I know about intelligent AI? Not a whole lot, but I'm working on projects that have an aspect of intelligence and embedded intelligence in particular. So let's see, Alias is essentially the idea of, in a helicopter, normally you have two pilots. According to the plan, one of the things they want to do in this project is to... Oh, by the way, I work for United Technologies, which is this big global corporation that owns the likes of Otis, you know, elevators, a Carrier, they do air conditioning systems and climate control. Edwards, they do fire protection and, detection and suppression. And then there's the what used to be called Hamilton Sunstrand that do aerospace components. They used to have also Sikorsky that was sold to Lockheed Martin recently. But they acquire now Rockwell Collins, which is also in aerospace sector. Anyway, and many of these projects are sponsored by government agencies like DARPA and Homeland Security. Okay, so Alias, this is basically the idea, is that you want to replace or augment, not necessarily replace the second pilot, but have like an assistant robotic pilot to assist the human pilot. And when I say robotic, I don't think of R2-D2 or C-3PO. Think of something that's embedded in the helicopter that helps the pilot perform certain routine actions, including in planning, flight plans, and it can be done at the controls level, can be done at the mission level, all different things. C2E, it's another interesting one. This originally also a tactical project, but it has clearly commercial applications. The idea is that you have radio system, And at some point, something happens, whether it's because someone is trying deliberately to jam the communication or because there's some technical problems, bad weather, who knows. You start having a higher error rate, for example. The two systems have to communicate with each other and figure out how they can reprogram and reconfigure themselves so they can continue to communicate in a contested or unfriendly environment. And the thing is that the way they can configure itself is not hardwired. They have to kind of intelligently figure out, is sending me the other point trying to tell me to switch protocols? What protocol does it want me to use? You know, you have to kind of, it's non-trivial problem, but very interesting. SenseNet, this is actually something I should start working again maybe in a few months. So this is has to do with detecting and reacting to hazardous agents in a confined environment, typically a building. So the idea is that, okay, you have a building, there could be an accident or maybe terrorist attack, someone is putting anthrax or chlorine or mustard gas in the air conditioning system, what do you do? First of all, you have to find out that it's happening, and then you have to decide, is this dangerous enough that it's something that we need to worry about? If so, what do we do? And what is it? If it's chemical, typically it's easier because you have sensors for chemical that you can actually confirm immediately. If it's biological, not so clear. It's hard to distinguish anthrax from pollen. They're you know, organic material. It's not so easy to tell them apart. So you have used things based on fluorescence to have a probability that could be one or the other. And once you have that, you have to make decisions about what to do. Sometimes difficult decisions, but that's a different subject. And then this last one is called the IRIS, Sense Over Intelligent Robotics and Integrated Systems. And the topic on which I'm involved is neuromorphic tactile system for texture recognition. I was kind of mentioned that to you earlier. So the idea is that in the context of advanced manufacturing, they want to have some kind of system that have this kind of artificial skin that can sense the material and determine the texture and the curvature of the object. So why is it important? Please.
So, and again, I'm not totally familiar with the...
thought you knew everything about...
About military applications and... But you frame it as there's no cloud that you can rely on.
May not be.
Yeah, but that's the point.
Right.
So what if you can have access to it, mm-hmm. but it's not reliable? So is it better to assume that there's no access whatsoever? Or is it better to, if I have access, then I can do more things, or if I don't?
I think so again, I'm not as much of an expert myself in this kind of strategic decisions, but my understanding is that you want to have the flexibility of not relying on it for extended periods of time. Mm-hmm. If it's there and it's safe to use it, by all means, and safe I mean reliable communication as well as people not spying on you, great. If you don't, and you know, typically in a mission you don't, or you have, but according to very, very constrained.
Is that one of the things that AI is supposed to figure out for you? That's one of the questions AI is supposed to answer. Is whether you can rely on your inputs.
It could, in terms of planning, that in terms of you could have, you know, and this is kind of an ambitious goal, you can have a system kind of decide at runtime what are the goals at the mission level. You know, for example, the mission was, let's go there, do this action, and come back and say, wait, something happened, you have to change the goal. Those are risky, this is risky, and I'll spend a little more time on this because, you know, when you start letting machine making decisions as in terms of the goals, now we get into dangerous territory. All right, so why is it important? Many reasons, but one of them is that we already see right now that autonomous intelligence system, for example, can equal and even surpass human performance on some tasks, some, as underlined and emphasized, okay? Clearly, we're not in the so-called artificial general intelligence arena yet. We're talking about systems that can perform very specific, very constrained tasks, and on these tasks, they can do very well, better than humans in many cases. So this is a very pretty dramatic demonstration. This is a good video I got from my former colleagues. They have a drone, you might have seen this one, I don't know. In mid-flight, it loses half of a wing, half of the rudder, in half of an elevator, and he still manages to relearn to fly and land. Now, the flying, the mission is, this is a drone, meaning there's a human pilot on the ground controlling it, but it's controlled at a kind of a fairly abstract level, so controlled at a kind of stay level, or nose up, or nose down, these kind of things. How that translates into controlling the actual actuators, this is mediated by an adaptive control intelligence system.
Okay, so I'm going to go to a video here, because I think it's pretty impressive.
But nothing special.
Now, how big is that?
Big what? Probably. Yes. 4 feet or something like that. It's not a full size aircraft. So we probably missed the place, but you can see, right? Okay, now it's, you can see it in slow motion. So if this was a human pilot, they would crash. Because there's a way you can learn to, you know, keep it stable without half of the surface of one wing. But the system can learn right away to adjust the parameters of the controllers and maintain the set points. Mm. Mm. All right, so now we'll see land. It's really dramatic when you see from this angle. It's wobbling a little bit, but you can do it. Anyway, so that was one thing. That was, I think it's interesting, you know, not so many words, but okay. Did I stop at the beginning? All right, let's go back to, because I have two versions now. All right, so. Here's another interesting application. Someone who was talking about about industrial automation. So, I mentioned before I worked for Magneti. Worked for Magneti Marelli, which is part of Fiat. And when I was working for them, I had opportunity to visit their manufacturing plants like Mirafiori and Lingotto, and looked like pretty much like that. They have these long rows of big, humongous machines that each of them does one little thing. They do the soldering, they whatever they do, right? Humongous investments justify when you have big volumes, you know, like it's the case in car manufacturing. And in those days, these were called robots, still are, but obviously there's no intelligence. Everything was prescriptive in terms of how they were programmed. Sorry. In the aerospace sector, it's completely different. You don't have the volumes. This is the Osprey, and this is, by the way, if you're curious, this is on the left corner. The Osprey is this kind of interesting thing that starts, that does vertical and takeoff and landing, but then when it's in the air, it basculates forward, and the propeller, the, you know what I'm saying, it turns into a fixed wing aircraft, basically. I visited this plant in Philadelphia at the end of 2013, I believe. It just looks like that, except that it was there were only one of those at the time. Anyway, the point is that it's all manual. They have these, you know, they pull these frames in the assembly line. And then they stop there for like a couple of days. They do all the assembly. Sorry, I'm going to turn this off. Right, so in this kind of situation, those kind of big, expensive industrial robots are clearly not an option. They don't justify the investment. And you don't make enough of these to justify the investment. So, what you want is some robot that you can, that's just different operations. And it learns from experience, if you like, on how to help the human. So you still have humans in the loop, so to speak, but they're assisted by machines. machines that you can say, you know, R2D2, give me the screwdriver or whatever, and this goes and finds where it is. And he remembers where he put last time, so it doesn't have to go get it from the shed. He knows, oh, the last time we used the screwdriver was there. We're going to go get it there. Things like that. Also, it's a shared environment, so they have to learn how to predict intent from the human, so they don't run someone over, for example. I mean, this is one case. There are other situations where you have this kind of human-robotic interaction in the case of loading cargo bays in aircrafts and ships. That's another application of these kind of things. So when you have this kind of automation, these kind of robots, it's all about perception. There's intelligence, yes, but perception is a big aspect of it. So visual perception, tactile. You say tactile or tactile? Either one? Auditory, and then you have other things like weight, temperature, blah, blah, blah. And the holy grail of this whole thing is what we refer to as data fusion, meaning you get visual data, sound data, touch, put them together real time to get the real picture of what's going on in the environment. There's a lot of progress being made, but it's far from an achieved goal. It's a very active field of research. Okay, so how does it work? Now we get into the more geeky technical details that some of you might be quite familiar with. So feel free to correct when I say something stupid. Machine learning. Okay, so machine learning is the aspect that enables embedded artificial intelligence more than, well, that along with perception, if you like, but certainly machine learning is a big game changer. You can read my definition. It is a different definition you can find. Every person you ask, they have slightly different twist on it, but basically the idea is that instead of being programmed, they're not programmed to do something, the machine are programmed to learn how to do something. That's more or less is the distinction. And there are three big categories: supervised learning, unsupervised, and reinforcement learning. I'm going to spend a little bit of extra time on supervised learning because it has a lot of applications, and it's what that's where most of the progress has been made. Reinforcement learning, I found fascinating. So far, the main applications have to do with games, which is an interesting research topic. But it's, I don't know, you guys might know more than I do, but I'm not familiar with a lot of practical, impactful, real-world applications yet, but I'm sure it will come. Essentially, reinforcement learning, meaning you're trying to achieve a goal. You know what the desirable goal is, you know what the undesirable goals are, figure out the strategy to get there, avoiding the bad stuff, essentially. And this is why it works well with games. Okay. Okay. Machine learning is exploding now, largely. Well, there have been some algorithmic improvements, but the big change is the hardware. Now we have powerful hardware that makes it possible. You probably have heard of GPUs, which stands for graphical processing units. So these are the things that in modern computer enable, you know, us to play games that have very fast and very sophisticated graphics. What's good about these processors is that they're very parallel in terms of the operation they perform. Well, guess what? In machine learning, the actual numerical computation is all matrix algebra. So you can parallelize all the numerical computation, and these graphical processors are really perfect for that. So, and of course, there's some with that. You know, we have software and frameworks that support that kind of hardware, so the two things go hand in hand. But the big enabler is the hardware. So, all right, let's talk about neural networks, because this is a very interesting technical aspect, and there are some experts in this room I know, but still, let's see if we can learn something new anyway. So basically, what is a deep learning, we probably heard that expression, is a fancy hype name for machine learning system, so computer system that learn. They're based on the use of deep artificial neural network. And an artificial neural network is an architecture, could be hardware, could be software, or a combination of the two, that mimics a network of biological neurons. These guys here, I don't remember which ones are the synapses, which ones are dendrites, or whatever, but you know, you probably have seen pictures of biological neurons that we have in our brain and nervous system. So an artificial neuron is essentially an artifact, a computational artifact that tries to mimic the same idea. And the idea is that you take the inputs, you perform some function, typically weighing the different weights or importance, if you like, of the inputs and make a decision. And decision is the output should be 0 or 1, meaning, yes, I see something interesting, no, I don't. As a matter of fact, this is a technicality, the output is not typically is not 1 or 0. It has to be continuous because you have to, well, that's not here. But anyway, so essentially it's yes or no answer. And so when you combine a lot of these things in a big structure, you get something like this. That's a deep neural network. In this case, it has 7 layers, input, output, and 5 so-called hidden layers. So when you hear the expression deep learning, it doesn't mean it's deep as in profound or special. It just means there's a lot of layers there. That's what it means. Okay, now, what do we do with them? One typical application is recognizing pictures of cats, or more in general, do image classification. And so this is the typical case. You see an image, and then this guy decides, yeah, I bet it's not because of how this learning process works, I figured out that 90% it's a cat, but this is 7% probability it's a dog, or maybe it's something completely different, who knows. In this case, we'll probably say, yeah, it's a cat, 90% is good enough, right? And there's all the mysterious stuff going on here, and I'll get to that. So, training neural networks means simply that neural networks are widely used in supervised learning for image classification, not just image classification, but that's a very typical application of neural networks. So basically what we do, we give it a training set, what that means, like a gazillion images, and for each image we know what category or categories they belong to. So through an iterative process, which I will not describe here, the system adjusts all these parameters and figures out, okay, I find the solution, then you test it, and you find out that, and then you give it, you test it by essentially feeding it other images for which you do know the answer, and you check whether the answer it gives you is correct or not. If you're happy with the results, you say, okay, great, I'm done, my network is trained. And then you start using it to make inference. Inference meaning a given image for which I do not know what the category is, and the system will tell me. I don't know if it's reasonably clear, but anyway. Now, the problem with these things is that in real life, these systems can be very, very complicated. There's a lot of parameters that get trained in the process. And at the end, the algorithm that turns out to be implemented by this thing is very difficult to understand. I would say impossible in most of the cases. And I will spend more time on this in a little bit, because that's a very important point. Now, let's take a little detour on perception, another element of artificial embedded intelligence. Like I said, we have different types of perception. We have visual, tactile, auditory, and other ones. In the case of visual, we have, you know, aspects that have to do with determining my meaning, the system's position with respect to the environment, or identify what objects are in the environment. And then when it comes to touch, you want to determine, talk about proximity to objects, features of object, texture, shape, and so on. Now, the visual perception is coming of age. There's a lot we can do already in visual perception. This, you might recognize some faces here, probably not, that's me anyway. And you were there too, I think you took the picture, right?
I did.
Yeah. Anyway, so I put this through, the reason why I chose a folder we took as opposed to one that you can get from the web is to make the point that these tools are very, very accessible. You don't have to have a supercomputer or just with a laptop. And if you know your way to hack things a little bit, you can come up with this thing in it straight up. Especially if you use a pre-trained model, which is what I did here. But a key point here. So we can do a lot of things with visual perception, classification, meaning what is this thing that I'm seeing? Detection, meaning where is it? Tracking, where it's going, I'm following it. And action detection, what is it doing? This is probably the hardest one of the four, but we're getting there. Problem is that the accuracy of classification in artificial intelligence is not as good as what people can do. It's still quite impressive statistically, but on a specific case, you never know what it comes up with. Anyway, so this is a little video. I'll probably it's an interesting application of that same thing, but at real time and stuff. So it recognizes cars.
Yeah.
Which program do you use to do this?
YOLO Darknet.
TDO.
Stands for you look only once. You only look once. Because of the algorithm, the way it's structured, that's what it's called. And with the COCO set, I believe, the training set. Yeah. All right. So, let's move on. Because this is a pretty long video, we don't need to watch it all. This is another aspect of visual perception that has nothing to do with object classification or recognition or identification. We just have to do with recognizing what's the environment around me, or the system, I should say. This is a typical case when you have a LiDAR image that it could be from an aircraft trying to, you know, doing autonomous flight, trying to figure out where is the ground, what objects could be in the way. It doesn't need to know that this is a building or this is a tower. There's no object classification involved here. It's not necessary. All you need to know is that there's something there, I don't want to hit it, stay clear. Okay, visual is good, like we said, it's coming of age. Tactile, not so good. So, I was going to do a little demonstration here. I don't know if we have time, but we can try. So if I have a volunteer that's willing to help me, we can play a little game. Anybody? Like Claudia, for example? So this comes in two parts. The first part, you're the robot and the human.
Okay.
Or another robot, if you like.
Okay.
So the point is, I want you to grab this and put it on the table without breaking it. Quite easy, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now let's do something not so easy. Now, I'll give you, no, put that down. I'll give you this. Don't break it. Perfect. Now give it back to me. Now we can do it with our real hands, right? Now you do the same with that thing, but keep it horizontal. No, open it up. More. Right, okay, that's good enough. Ready? Try not to break it. Okay. Sorry, try again. Is that right? Wow, you did it.
Well,
okay,
this was
not supposed to end this way. I used two hands. But you get the point. This. Thank you, Claudia. A fantastic performance. the point here is that typically, and I tried this at home several times, and it's good, evidently, I always end up doing something like this, right? You know what I'm saying. I crack it because it's fragile, and this with this thing, I don't have any sensitivity. So what is the point here? The point is that you cannot do...
Sorry,
guys.
I don't think I have time to cover all this, but I'll try to do my best. So what is the point here? The point is that tactile perception is not easy. Because,
visual coordination and fine control is not enough when you have objects that are fragile and small. So, for example, another thing that I was going to, forget about the candy, there's no time for that. You probably have noticed, when you plug in something, you look at it first, that's a quick visual inspection, you know where the output is, you know where the plug is, you look, and then once you get to a certain degree of proximity, you don't care about the side, just go by touch, right? That's the missing part here, is that we do not have systems that are able to do that with the same degree of ability as humans, not even close. So these are some examples, right? So how do you pick up a fragile object? How do you insert the plug into an outlet? How do you decide how much pressure you need? This is interesting. To hold a slippery object, they could imagine the glass thing, maybe slippery, there's grease on it or whatever, so you want to hold it just enough that you don't drop it, but not enough you break it. You can't just do it by looking at it and adjusting the control. You have to feel some. You have to be some feedback from the top.
You have to know it's glass too, or a potato chip, or it's weak.
Well, that even if you did know it was glass,
yeah.
So even if you have the field knowledge, if you like, the domain knowledge that I have to be careful with this. How will you be careful? How can you be careful? Even if you know you have to.
You need the 10th.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Okay, so this is another video where we show the robot opening the, I'll skip this because you probably have seen it before. It's very popular. The problem is that the point is the robot opens the door by grabbing the handle. That's easy because the handle is steel and it has to take it down like this. If it was something more delicate, it wouldn't be so easy. That's really the point I'm trying to make. So here is, no, that's just really okay. This is an example of something interesting that I was discussing with one of my colleagues a few weeks back. Essentially, okay, here we go. Hey. I don't know what's going on.
Right.
I usually use an external cue. So essentially, this is a technology. So typically, the so-called e-skins tend to be these layers of piezoelectric sensors connected on some kind of flexible material. In this case, these guys are experimenting something very interesting. Basically, the idea is that you have this gelatinous surface on which the pressure is exercised on one side. On the other side, you have light. And the deformation of the surface, which is an indication of the pressure, is revealed by changes in lighting with respect to the baseline. And they use that to infer how much pressure and what direction the pressure is applied by looking at the shades, the shadows, basically, on the back side of the fan, which I think is a very creative solution. I don't know if it's... It's probably complicated, but I think it's an interesting idea. Just to show you that it's, you know, this is a complicated, complex problem, and people are coming up with very interesting experiments to come up with a solution. Okay, we're running out of time. I really want to get to the. Okay, can we trust it? Now this is a big. Let me repeat, big question. The answer is not yet, but I'll tell you why. So we know that AI is powerful, blah 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 blah, can do a lot of things very well. Again, I'll skip through this words, but okay. Now this is I don't know if you feel like reading it, but basically you probably have heard of this case and cases like this. There are some courts in this country where they have decided to adopt these algorithms as a way to decide who gets parole, who doesn't, who gets long sentences, who doesn't. And like in this case, the guy said, wait a second, you gave me a sentence because of this algorithm says that I'm high risk. How do you know that I'm high risk? Well, evidently there's some kind of algorithm that was trained on existing cases, and it determines that because of his, I don't know, ethnicity, age, marital status, health, all these factors, he was high risk. Is that true? We don't know. All we know is that the training set says that he was. The training set is based on ground truth that was labeled by humans who could have been biased. If the people who could label the data are biased, the learned system is just equally biased. So this is a terrible way to use machine learning, in my opinion. I don't know if you agree, but and unfortunately, this stuff happens. Right. So this is really bad use of machine learning. Why? Like I said, first of all, if there's bias in the training set, there's bias in the learned system. There's no way around it. And in this case, the term bias works both in the common exception of the term as well as the statistical exception of the term, I think. And the other reason, which I'll spend some more time later, is that deep learning, especially deep learning algorithms, based on deep neural networks, are by definition black box algorithms. Because, and like I said before, they're statistically, well, maybe I didn't, I'm saying it now, they're statistically impressive, but individually unreliable. So meaning you can feed your system a million images. On 999,999, it gives you the right answer, and then it comes up with this, right? You never know. A human would know that, no, this is not a baseball bat, but a machine doesn't necessarily know. So it's very accurate statistically, but you never know in a single case where it is telling you the right thing or not. So it's still very mature in that sense. So you can use it for statistical applications. Use it for individuals, like determine, yes, you go to jail, no, you don't. I don't know.
Max?
Yeah?
If you want, I can
add
a couple words on that.
Right.
So part of it is to do with how the new image that you're showing it corresponds with the image. So if it's something like an example that was really rare in the training set, or something that never happens in the training set, then you can rely less and less and less.
As more as the distribution that you're testing on is different from the distribution you're training on, the less you can rely on.
Right.
So this is a part of it. And so if you try to pick from the long tail of the distribution that you're training on, then you will find like a lot of these errors.
Right.
So if you think about like the image capturing tasks, you will see that if you have like a really rare image in the training set, but that's something that could happen in the real world, you will find like some descriptions that make no sense.
Yeah, that's right.
So this is one problem, and on the other side, there are some techniques that try to go around this problem. Several of them. One in particular that could be interesting for the discussion here is that there are techniques like, for instance, Bayesian neural networks, where you have associated with a specific data point, not only the probability of belonging to a certain class, but also the degree of certainty of the model itself.
Okay.
So that it can say, for instance, I have this image, and for this image I say that it is a cat, with 90% probability, but also with 70% variance, which is telling me that you should not rely on this prediction. While on another image I have 90% probability and 1% variance, so I'm really certain of what it says.
Isn't the criteria whether it can beat a human? In other words, whether it's right more often than a human is right?
The criteria for
accepting this, allowing this algorithm to take over a normal human task.
I would say, if I understand the question, it depends on what the application. And what do you want to do with it? Like I said, when you use it to make important decisions that have to do with people, I'll say, be very, very careful, because we're not mature enough yet. But if you're using to, for applications which, at the end, one error here and there ends up being, part of a, I can't think of the word right now. Something that is one component of many in which it doesn't steer the result one way or the other too much, then it's perfectly adequate at this point. I don't know if I'm answering the question.
Sorry.
Okay.
I think the observation is that there are so in your example, right, everyone can be 100% certain that it's not a baseball bat.
Right.
But there are situations where even a human is not 100%.
No, of course not.
Right.
Of course.
So you can have physician looking at the CT scan and may not see that there is a cancer.
Absolutely.
So you may have a situation where maybe the machine is still uncertain, but can be more reliable than a human.
That's true. Okay, so I was going to give a little live demonstration on this side. You might be familiar with. We're going to create a little toy neural network with a set of data and show how the resulting model is accurate statistically, and yet we know that has very little to do with the data, with the structure of the inputs. I don't think we have time for that, so we might come back to that later, but let me just instead give you the theoretical explanation I was going to demonstrate. So model checking is a technique that is used in system verification. Say, I have an implementation of something, does it work? So basically it is that I know what my model is, or in other words, I know what my intended behavior is, I implement it using an algorithm, using a circuit, whatever, and then I do some checking on it, and there's different ways to do that. Testing is one of them. Model checking is a form of validation that has to do with, I know certain property that my model satisfy. Does the implementation satisfy the same properties? And so if it does, I declare victory, say yes, this implementation is a correct implementation of that model. So if the model is y is x squared plus 1, you know what the answer is. It doesn't matter if the implementation is an electronic calculator, an abacus, or you're counting on your finger, it doesn't matter. You know what the acceptable answer is, and you can verify it. In the case of neural networks, that's not the case, because there is no model. So let's say, for example, that you have a certain property, or a certain, I should say, behavior that it corresponds to this is a parabola, basically. Well, the problem is I don't have a parabola. I don't know what analytical function I am getting the data from. All I have are the plain data. I have to work off that. I have no idea if there's a model, what that model is behind the data. So when I do learning on it, I can come up with something that it probably matches the model, if it exists, where the data are there, where they're not, I don't know. So was there a model behind it? I don't know. Is it the right one? I don't know. So I'm not saying that this is wrong. I just have no idea of how to answer the question because I do not know what's behind this, if anything. Right? So that's a big thing with trying to check to validate neural networks. Another case that is interesting is that of the recommender system. This is a little bit of a different thing. I'll spend just 30 seconds on this. The idea, basically, you probably have used Netflix, Amazon, all these kind of services. You choose movies or products. Next thing you know, people say, oh, you may be interested in buying this, or maybe interested in watching that. Why? Because they think you watch, romance movies versus action movies or war movies or whatnot, or you like to buy shoes instead of socks instead of jackets. Nothing like that. The way these things work in general is like a, okay, I forgot the term right now. It's collaborative algorithm, it's learning algorithm.
Collaborative filtering.
What?
Collaborative filtering.
Yeah, thank you. So basically, products and movies or whatever it is, thank you very much, they get placed in certain areas of the feature space. And by similarity, if you tend to buy things or watch movies that end up for that reason in this area of the learned space, if other movies watched by other people end up in the same space, that movie will be recommended to you. Why? We do not know. Because these features have no interpretation attached to them. It doesn't mean that this is romance and this is action. We don't know. They're just artificial products of the mathematical model that produces them. This is a little less mysterious, but it kind of makes the point that we learn things, we just don't know what we're learning.
The sensors are the people that are important.
In this case, you can say that the sensors are. Okay, so here that's why there's an effort to come up with something called explainable artificial intelligence. So the idea is that it's not enough to learn something. I want to know what I have learned. In other words, okay, you tell me that when I get this input, I get this output. Great. Tell me why. Why did you come to that decision? Right? This is actually a DARPA initiative that we meaning myself and other people in my office, we submitted a proposal. It was rejected, unfortunately, but they are working on it. And that's the effort, try to understand if we come up with models that are not just statistically accurate, but you can trust them because there's an explanation that you can come up with. You can come up with a model. You can, in other words, from the data, derive the model in some way. So what can we expect? I guess this is a kind of, I don't know what we can expect. That's a short answer, but a few ideas. A couple of things that I decided to, that kind of things we probably want to, if not answer, at least think about is, there's an interesting idea of combining paradigms like blockchain with artificial intelligence, as well as machine automata learning combined with reinforcement learning. I'm not going to spend any time to explain what these things are. The point is that there are different technologies that people claim could take advantage of artificial intelligence in some form and make them, you know, enable them to take them to the next level. You can use artificial intelligence for creative applications, not just to get information from, say, images or other raw data, but to create them. And you probably have seen this Google project that has to do with turning simple images into this like hallucination like kind of things. You probably have seen some of this. I found it pretty disturbing. But it'll basically reverse the process. I'm not sure about the details, but this is what they come up with. Kind of makes me keep with it. Yeah, I don't know about you, but it's interesting though. Very creative. It's like, you know. Anyway. Okay, so is this a revolution or an evolution? This guy, you probably know, if you know anything about machine learning, you probably heard his name. He says this is like the new electricity. Maybe true, maybe not. We'll see. I believe that's probably maybe not for within my lifetime and maybe not within my children's lifetime, but I think that these kind of technologies will cause massive changes in the way we live. It's like Karl Marx said, the technology determines the social structure. basically take capital, you condense it to a sentence, that's what it says. I think this is one of the technologies that can really change the social structure and everything we do. That we probably won't live long enough to know, but I think it's coming.
No.
You disagree?
I disagree, yeah.
Okay,
no.
Sure.
I plan to,
I don't know if
I plan to live long enough.
That's it, yeah. Sure. And then we get into the almost over the artificial general intelligence. What is that? Well, that means refers to the idea that a machine will be able to perform any intellectual task that a human can, whatever that means. So there are different levels. Applied intelligence, what we have now. You have a specific task, you can learn how to do it. We're pretty much there, or, you know, getting there. General intelligence, well, learn to, ability to learn independently, any task, not just that specific task. And then the big thing is just self-awareness. See, I don't buy this one because even if machines acted as if they were self-aware, how do you know what's going on inside? We don't have a theory of mind about machines. I don't know if you are familiar with the term theory of mind. The idea is that as humans, I see another person, I recognize that it's human, and I project the fact that this other person has feelings, fears, whatever, the same that I have.
Which could be wrong.
You should be wrong. I could be the only conscious entity in the entire universe, as far as I'm concerned. But I assume that you also have thoughts and feelings, and you see me the same way, or, you know, sort of the same way I see you. Can we make the same assumption for machines? I don't know.
No, but maybe one machine can recognize that in another machine.
But how do you know? What do they do? That's a big question. I couldn't be inside someone's. So we will never be in someone else's head, let alone in a machine's head, right? Not the purple, I'm talking about this.
I'm saying one machine could have an empathy with another.
So are you telling that we will always fail the Turing test?
Yeah, that's my guess. Mm-hmm. We'll see. Well, like I said, probably not. Maybe. So, be worried, I don't know. Should we worry a little bit, maybe? You've probably seen this cover. I don't know. That's kind of clever. I think this robots own the world and, you know, humans are left. You know. On the side there. There will be consequences. There you go. But the point is, you know, the key of, I think that the message is, will there be a time where we as humans will have nothing of value to do except being entertained? I don't know. Could be 10 generations.
Well, there is that joke about the scientists that perfect the artificial intelligence computer and finally get it absolutely perfected and ask it the big question, is there a God?
Mm-hmm.
And the computer thinks about it and says, there is now.
Do you know about the Church of Artificial Intelligence, the of Anthony Randolph, the guy that made the big, by the way, he lives in Berkeley, so close by to you.
In Berkeley, the third most beautiful city in America, as we just found out. That's only there. Okay. Anyway, I'm done with this thing, and this is a list of people. Some say we need to be very careful, some people are very cavalier about it. You take your pick, and probably around here, more or less. And that concludes my presentation. And last thing, I want to acknowledge and thank a few people that you had never heard of, but well, some of them you might. And they helped me with very interesting discussions to come up with ideas. Thank you.
So we have a few minutes for questions.
Q&A, yes. Yes.
So I'd like to go back to your definition of embedded.
Yes.
And you said that embedded is when there is no connection to the cloud. That is one of the criteria that you use for.
It's embedded in some physical object that interacts with the environment.
And I wonder in a situation where the infrastructure for the internet is really expanding, and you know you find the Wi-Fi really everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
If that definition is really necessary now,
I don't know. Obviously, I'm just thinking that if biological evolution is any indication, having a self-sufficient intelligent capability in the system itself is probably an evolutionary advantage. So I presume that machines will follow the same route, but we'll see.
Is this a continuum of what used to be called knowledge engineering, whereby they took a very limited problem set, say a diagnostic for cancer, and
yeah.
they fed it in all the diagnostic tests, and they mined the foremost experts in the world to suck their knowledge into the program and programmed it, manually programmed it in. And then the computer was able to, in that limited domain, was able to come out with a diagnosis of cancer, which helped the doctor speed up the diagnosis.
Right. I am not familiar with knowledge engineering at all, so I'm afraid I can't.
It was popular back in the 90s. And
I missed that.
Yeah, okay. Before your time.
No, not before my time. I was probably busy doing something else.
Do you see a limit to the power of this technology, or so do you think we are just starting to see the potential, or we are approaching kind of a wall of
Everything has limits, obviously. I don't think we're even close to getting to hitting the wall. I mean, we last month we heard Marco's talk on quantum computing. They can do all these super, complex in terms of runtime, complex algorithmic tasks. Best of my knowledge, the type of problems that we're having here are not terrible. Well, there's some algorithmic complexity certainly, but especially when it comes to training, for example. But I think the big challenges are trying, like I said, number one is understand what we're learning, and there's a limitless, apart from the technological development, there is the big explosion we're going to see in the next year, my guess is, not so much in technological advancement or artificial intelligence technology, but it will be an explosion of artificial intelligence applications that will reuse things that already exist with some minor improvements, but it will see become more and more ubiquitous. Not necessarily more advanced, but we'll see it everywhere in many more fields, I think. That's my guess.
Isn't the development of the data set that you train it on the limitation now? Because
that's
not
a limitation. That's a big
it,
limitation.
If you don't have a good data set,
yeah.
you got garbage
yeah.
in, garbage
you need,
out.
Right. There are two big problems. One, you have to have data.
Mm-hmm.
That's inherently a problem. And second, these data have to be reliable label. That's your humongous challenge. Because now, for example, the labeling they do things like, use things like Amazon, turkey. But it's basically people sitting on a computer looking, click, yes, cat, no, dog, no, something. And this, yeah, I don't know, the quality
you,
is probably
you,
what
you
it is.
You move the intelligence to the people that are doing the data preparation, have you not?
Yeah, yeah. So maybe that's the future. We'll be doing data labeling and the machines will be in charge, who knows. But yeah, that's definitely a big challenge. You know, but, yeah.
So can you or anybody in the room give a flawless example of a working and again flawless application of artificial intelligence?
I'm sorry, what kind of
any example that
yeah.
be flawless and totally working on
AlphaGo.
Games, that's a very good example. This is sort of with the reinforcement learning primarily.
Mm-hmm.
So this game AlphaGo, which I'm not super familiar, but it's a Google version to play this game called Go. And an interesting thing about this and other games, once we feed them through artificial intelligence systems, is they come up with move after a learning period. They first lose, and they start winning. And when they learn to win, they come up with moves that people know how to play. So, like, what the hell are you doing? And it turns out in the long run that move is a winning move.
Mm-hmm.
And they figured out strategies the human could not understand. Until you, then at the end you see, oh, that's right. So I think that's an interesting. And actually, there was something I read about these really, maybe it was the case of Go, where these masters of the game that somehow come up with these moves that they don't know how to explain why they did it. They just have this intuition, this is going to work. And it's kind of a similar process, probably. But yeah, no, I see what you're saying. So there's not no. It's hard to identify a really flawless application at this point. But on the other hand, is there anything, artificial intelligence or not, that always works flawlessly? That's kind of a very general.
Driving, self-driving car. May I say that? The new machine.
Yes, and maybe.
You still don't see driving car.
So one question. I assume that in the future, you know, as long as the artificial intelligence stays in the labs or in the military or a very industrial application, it's one problem. The moment the artificial intelligence starts to come to our cars, our working places, our homes, our doctor, then people will start to react. So is this idea of explaining, capability of explaining, also a way to facilitate
absolutely.
Help the
absolutely.
Acceptance.
I was last week at this summit called Digital Cities Summit at Stanford, and they were talking about what is the future of the digital city. And one of the things was traffic, and of course they talked about autonomous vehicles and that kind of stuff. And one of the speakers was this woman who was working for the Obama administration and shortly for the Trump administration that she resigned. Good for her. But anyway, and her talk was about a comparison of the legal framework for autonomous vehicle in Europe, European Union, and Germany in particular, and the legislative framework in the US. And basically, the US is not. It's just, whatever, build trust. Just make sure that whatever you do, put it in writing. That's the essence of it. In Europe, it's much more precise. Directives of what they do. For example, in Germany specifically, there's a directive that says it's mandatory that in the case of if the machine has a choice between hurting the passenger or hurting a third party, the third party shall not be hurt. They have to make a precise. It's very prescriptive. You cannot hurt the passenger, even if that means killing the driver. The US doesn't have like that. Another thing that was interesting is the, I forgot right now, but it was, what was the question again? Because I forgot what I was trying to say. What was that?
It was about acceptance.
Acceptance, exactly. One of the other things, this is not Germany specifically, but the EU, one of the directives is, or the proposed directives, is that there has to be some kind of black box, so that whenever there's a problem, not only you know what happened, but there has to be an explanation of why certain action was taken. Which, if you know anything about neural networks, like we said before, it's going to be really, really hard to do. Mm-hmm. So. Anything else? Please.
If I can add a little point of discussion.
Go ahead.
On one side, you have this problem of explainability and also the problem of understanding the inner workings of the model.
Yeah.
On the other side, and it's probably another face of the same medal, there's a problem of potential adversarial examples that can be given to the models in general, neural networks in particular. Like recently, there's been like one specific paper that was really interesting where you could change even a single pixel of an image and change completely the outcome. So it's something that's completely unobservable by a human. So changing a single picture in a big image will not make any difference for a human, but that will change completely the outcome of the network.
Right.
And so, because these things are somehow common among even different algorithms and different networks, it could be the case that you can design specifically a way to hijack the network by showing it something that's and you can imagine that applying it to autonomous people that could be like really dangerous. It could be like could be fooled into thinking that there's a road ahead while there's no road ahead, or these kind of problems. So this is an additional problem with the adoption.
Right.
And it's less discussed, probably.
And you probably know that there had in the early days, not so early, but few years ago, there have been problems of autonomous vehicle that they do the same route in testing over and over again, and then one day end up going into the ditch because there's a track that leaves like a oil trace or something, and they get fooled into following something that's not there. So anyway, I think we're out of time, so thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Interesting presentation. And so we don't have yet a name for next month, so please watch your email and our page on Facebook, our Twitter account, and our page on Meetup, and you will find out pretty soon the name of the next presentation. Thank you very much for coming.